Lesson 2, The Elixir of Life, written by C.V.Raman. So before we begin with the lesson, let's know what is elixir. So what is elixir? It is nothing but a liquid with magical potion or power. So they say that if a person drinks this potion, that is, the person gets eternal life, or is granted with immortality, that is, the person will never die. It's similar like Harry Potter and the Philosopher's Stone. What happens to him when he gets that Philosopher's Stone? He becomes immortal. So it's the same thing over here. So let's know, what is that elixir of life that C.V. Raman is talking about? Man has, through the ages, sought in vain for an imaginary elixir of life, the divine amrita, to confer immortality. But the true elixir of life lies near to our hands, for it is the commonest of all liquids, plain water. So in the first paragraph, C.V. Raman is telling us that man has been searching for this imaginary elixir of life, that is the divine amrita. What is amrita? It is a Sanskrit word which literally means immortality. So here he is telling that the man has been searching for many ages, but it is in vain. No result. It is useless. Why? Because nobody has got that immortality. He is searching for immortality, for eternal life. He doesn't want to die. But he is telling the true elixir of life lies near to our hands, and it is the most commonest of all liquids. What is it? Plain water. So why is he telling plain water is the elixir of life? So let's go through the entire lesson now. I remember one day standing on the line which separates the Libyan desert from the valley of the Nile in Egypt. On one side was visible a sea of billowing sand without a speck of green or a single living thing anywhere visible on it, while on the other side lay one of the greenest, most fertile and densely populated areas to be found anywhere on the earth, teeming with life and vegetation. What made this wonderful difference? Why, it is the water of the river Nile flowing down to the Mediterranean from its sources a couple of thousands of miles away. So one day he remembers, C.V. Raman remembers, that one day he was standing on the line which was separating the Libyan desert from the valley of the Nile in Egypt. So he was standing between, one side he had Libyan desert, which is the part of Sahara desert, which is the largest desert in the entire world. And other side he had the valley of the Nile in Egypt. So what did he see one side, in Libyan desert? What did he see? He saw a sea of billowing sand. What is billowing? It filled or spreading over large area. So the entire area was covered with sand, and there was not even a single living thing or a speck of green. What is speck? A small spot or mark. So he did not see even one small plant there. It was entirely covered with sand. What did he see in the other side, that is on the valley of the Nile? It was completely opposite to the first one. What did you see there? Entire area was covered with greenery. It was the most greenest, most fertile and densely populated areas to be found. So entire area was covered with plants. It was greenery and teeming with life and vegetation. What is teeming? To have lot of things moving about in it. So obviously it had the birds and the animals, all the living creatures. So what made this wonderful difference? So he's asking, what is the reason that one side there is full of greenery and the other side it is covered with sand? What's the difference? So he's telling that difference is made because of the water of the river Nile flowing down to the Mediterranean from its sources a couple of thousands of miles away. That is, the main source of river Nile is somewhere far, thousands of miles away. But because of that water which is flowing down there, that has given life in one side, and the other side it is completely dry. Geologists tell us that the entire soil of the Nile Valley is the creation of the river itself. It was brought down as the finest silt in its flood waters, from the highlands of Abyssinia and from remote Central Africa, and laid down through the ages in the trough through which the Nile flows into the sea. Egypt, in fact, was made by its river. Its ancient civilization was created and is sustained by the life-giving waters which come down year after year with unfailing regularity. So in the third para, he tells that the geologist, who is a geologist? He is a scientist who studies the matter that constitutes the earth. They know about the materials of which it is made, the entire structure of the earth, or the study of the earth. That is done by geologists. So he is telling that geologists tell us that the entire soil of the Nile Valley is the creation of the river itself. That is, that soil was not present before. The river itself brought those soil there. How? It was brought down as the finest silt in its flood waters. What do you mean by silt? Silt is nothing but sand or soil or mud carried by flowing water and left at the mouth of the river. Because of this heavy rain and everything, the mud was being carried away by the water and that got stored there. And that's how that entire valley was created. So this mud was collected from where? Highlands of Abyssinia and from remote Central Africa. So from ages it's happening and laid down through the ages in the trough. What is trough? It is a low area between two higher areas. It's like a wave. Okay. So which the Nile River flows into the sea. Which sea? Mediterranean Sea. So here all this mud was being carried away by the flood waters and finally it got and stored there, and that's how the entire valley was created. So entire Egypt in fact was made by its river. Why? Because Egypt is most famous for its river Nile. So C.V.Raman is telling that Egypt was actually made because of its river. So its ancient civilization was created and is sustained. What is sustained? Kept alive by the life-giving waters which come down year after year. So after Egypt was created, the civilization started living. How does a civilization come and live? How does it start? First, what do they see? Whether there is water or not. So in case there is water, the people come and start living. So here also the same thing. They saw water and the civilization started living there. So that's how people started living there and life started growing there. I give this example and could give many others to emphasize that this common substance, which we take for granted in our everyday life, is the most potent and the most wonderful thing on the face of our earth. It has played a role of vast significance in shaping the course of the earth's history and continues to play the leading role in the drama of life on the surface of our planet. Now he is telling that he is giving an example, similar example. So he can give many other examples like that to emphasize. What is emphasize? Get more attention or give more importance to what? To that common substance. What is that common substance? Water, which we have taken for granted in our daily life. We don't care. Water, huh? It's okay, fine. But actually that water is so important for everyone in every aspect of life. So he's telling this water is the most potent and the most wonderful thing on the face of earth. What is potent? It's the most powerful, that is strong, and on the face of earth, that is in the whole world, in the entire world, this water is so important. It has played a role of vast significance in shaping the course of earth's history. Obviously, because of water, you have learnt it in your social science, geography, maybe that because of water, the entire earth's history has changed and it has been improving day by day, and the water is playing a very important role in our life on the surface of a planet. In case, just imagine this earth did not contain water, then what would have happened? So you know what is the importance of water in our life. There is nothing which adds so much to the beauty of the countryside as water, be it just a little stream trickling over the rocks or a little pond by the wayside where the cattle quench their thirst of an evening. The rain-fed tanks that are so common in South India, alas, often so sadly neglected in their maintenance, are a cheering sight when they are full. They are, of course, shallow, but this is less evident since the water is silt-laden and throws the light back and the bottom does not therefore show up. These tanks play a vital role in South Indian agriculture. Some of these tanks are surprisingly large, and it is a beautiful sight to see the sun rise or set over one of them. Water in a landscape may be compared to the eyes in a human face. It reflects the mood of the hour, being bright and gay when the sun shines, turning to dark and gloomy when the sky is overcast. So here you know that water is very beautiful. So when you go to beaches, you know how beautiful it looks, sunrise or sunset time. Obviously you go to a beach and you admire the beauty of it. So same way here he's trying to say there's nothing which adds so much to the beauty of the countryside as water. What is countryside? It's a land or a scenery of rural areas. So here also he's telling that this little stream trickling, that is small narrow river which is flowing over the rocks, or a little pond by the wayside, that is edge of the road, you where the cattle, the cows are quenching their thirst. So it looks so beautiful. So he's telling this rain-fed tanks that are so common in South India. So he's telling, alas, often so sadly neglected. So what is alas? It is an expression there. So he's expressing sadness. That is, this rain-fed tanks are not cared or they are not looked after. So it is actually a cheering sight when they are full. When we see a rain-fed tanks completely full, they look very beautiful. But here he's telling that people are not taking care of it. So they are, of course, shallow. That is, they're not deep. Shallow is not deep. But this is less evident. Evident is clear, since the water is silt laden. That is, silt, as I said, mud. So carrying lot. Laden is nothing but carrying lot, and throws the light back and the bottom does not therefore show up. That is, the mud or the silt is thrown away and people are not caring for it. So these tanks play a vital role in South Indian agriculture. So these rain-fed tanks actually have a lot, or they play a very important role in the South Indian agriculture. So some of these tanks are surprisingly large and very they look very pretty or very beautiful sight to see when it is during sunrise or sunset. And they say that the water in the landscape may be compared to the eyes in a human face. Why? Just imagine you're standing in an area where you have a mountain and there's a small river or a lake, just like this, a small shallow river or a rain-fed, just like a tank or a lake. So you imagine during sunset, you can see the reflection and it looks very pretty. So he's telling it reflects the mood of the hour, being bright and happy when sun shines, turning to dark and gloomy. What is gloomy? Feel sad when the sky is overcast. What is overcast? Covered with clouds. So entire change in the nature. It looks very beautiful when you think of it. One of the most remarkable facts about water is its power to carry silt or finely divided soil in suspension. This is the origin of the characteristic color of the water in rain-fed tanks. This color varies with the nature of the earth in the catchment area and is most vivid immediately after a fresh inflow following rain. Swiftly flowing water can carry fairly large and heavy particles. The finest particles, however, remain floating within the liquid in spite of their greater density and are, of course, extremely small, but their number is also great. So here he is telling one of the most important facts about water is its power to carry silt or finely divided soil in suspension. Now you know that the water is very forceful. So it has lots of power. So it can carry the entire mud from one area. You know the destruction that the water causes sometimes. So here also it's telling it has the power to carry that silt or the finely divided soil in suspension. What is suspension? State of water with very small particles of sand and other particles. So this is the origin of the characteristic color of the water in rain-fed tanks. So this color, it changes or it depends on the nature of the earth in the catchment area. What is catchment area? It's an area which collects plentiful rainfall and is most vivid immediately after a fresh inflow flowing rain. That is, so here, as soon as it starts raining or it ends the following rain, if you just go and see this catchment area where the water is stored, you can see how clear the water is. The mud won't be collected a lot. It will be clear water. So in case you see after many days, what happens? The entire water, it takes even the mud with it and gets stored in some place. So the color changes. So it's trying to say that swiftly flowing water can carry fairly large and heavy particles. What is swiftly? Very fastly. So the finest particles, however, they remain floating. Some particles will be floating in that liquid, even if their density is greater, but the size will be small. So their number is also great. It depends. You have seen when you are when it's raining heavily and you put a paper boat on it. So it takes with it, goes with that flow. Same way, it also carries other different things. The flow of water has undoubtedly played a great part and a beneficent one in the geological processes by which the soil on the earth's surface has been formed from the rocks of its crust. The same agency, however, under appropriate conditions, can also play a destructive part and wash away the soil, which is the foundation of all agriculture, and if allowed to proceed unchecked, can have the most disastrous effects on the life of the country. The problem of soil erosion is one of the serious import in various countries and especially in many parts of India. The conditions under which it occurs and the measures by which it can be checked deserve the closest study. So in the seventh paragraph, he is telling that the flow of this water, it has played a great part in the entire geological processes by which the soil on the earth's surface has been formed from the rocks of its crust. Now here, same way, in under appropriate conditions, it is okay. The water is giving us a lot. Sometimes what happens, it also plays a destructive part. Now just for example, the floods, you know how bad it is. So here also it washes away the soil, which is the foundation of the agriculture. And if you have not checked it properly, what happens? It gives you disastrous effects. So the problem of soil erosion is very common in our areas, in parts of India especially. So you know what is soil erosion? Soil erosion is nothing but displacement of the upper layer of the soil. So what happens? The upper layer of the soil is taken away. So the conditions under which it occurs and the measures by which it can be checked deserve the closest study. We need to take care of it so that almost in India, half of India is taken care by the agriculture. So in case the agriculture gets spoiled, we won't have any food. So we need to take care of it